What is going on, people? Welcome back to a brand new episode of Identity Talk for Educators Live, the show for the unsung heroes of education. I'm your host, Kwame Sarfo-Mensah. And if this is your first time tuning in to the podcast as a listener or a viewer, we welcome you and we hope that you return back for future episodes. And if you're a returning listener or viewer of the podcast, we welcome you back. We hope that today's episode is one that you find inspiring, informative, and enlightening. So before we get to the main event, let's do a few quick announcements as we always do. We have the summer coming around the corner for many of our classroom teachers, which means that we need to re-up on our teacher swag, our power for next school year. So if you are a teacher or an educational professional who's looking for some new hoodies, some new shirts to wear in front of the screen with your students or in person with them, check out IDTALK4ED. We have all kinds of gear for the classroom teacher, the school librarian, and other educational professionals within the spectrum. So check us out at teespring.com/stores/the-identity-talk-apparel-shop for those who are listening with us today. And then finally, if you are looking for some professional development to do over the summer and you want to get some credits towards your license, we have our official Shaping the Teacher Identity Virtual 101 program, which you can do at your own pace. It's a self-paced program. And we cover a myriad of topics such as culturally responsive teaching, anti-racist practices, classroom management, lesson planning, time management, and overall just trying to identify what our identities are as teachers in the classroom. So if that sounds like you, book a call with us today at calendly.com/identitytalk4educators to check out our services. All right, y'all. So those are the public announcements. Let's get to the main event. So today we are talking to a phenomenal educator who I actually met recently, and I've been following her page intensely over the past month, and she is somebody who you're going to love, y'all. She's a straight shooter, and she's someone who's just going to tell like it is, and that's what we love about this podcast. It's all about people who are going to be truth tellers, and they're going to keep it real about what's going on in our classrooms and our institutions. So I want to introduce you to this phenomenal curriculum specialist, author. She's also a middle school social studies and ethnic studies teacher, and she is the founder of ESTE Publishing, which we're going to talk about in a little bit. So without further ado, let's bring on Miss Lucia Reyes to the podcast to speak with us. What is going on?
Hi, what's up, Kwame? Hi, everyone.
Yes, and thank you for coming on the podcast. I've been thoroughly excited for this interview. Just to give you full disclosure, you know, I'm a little under the weather, but you know what? I said I'm not missing this episode for the world. We had to have this conversation.
Oh, well, thank you so much. Thank you for having me. And I can't tell you're under the weather. You are dope. Thanks for having me.
Yes. Yeah. You're giving me life right now. That's why you're injecting life into me. So, yeah, let's go right in. So you're out in California. Are you in the Bay Area?
No, I'm actually in LA County, like in the northern high desert area outside of like in the northern fringes of LA County. Yeah, so that's me out there.
All right, cool. So first question I always ask my guests is to tell us a little about yourself and what brought you into the field of education.
So I'm a single mama. That's my first and most important job. I've got a 6-year-old. She's just wrapping up her kindergarten year in online teaching, which has been challenging, but she's incredible. And I've been in the field of education for 20 years. I actually never really had any interest in working with kids or wanting to be a teacher. I went to undergrad at UCLA, and I had a history, art history combined major. And I thought at that time that I wanted to be a curator. I love ancient history. I love history in general, studying different cultures, religions. I love travel. And I thought I wanted to be a curator. So after I graduated, I got this incredible internship at the Los Angeles County Museum of Arts and the Ancient and Islamic Art Department. But it was an unpaid internship. So I needed a job. I needed money. And my tia, my aunt, she had always been involved in community work, and she was part of this new project opening up this youth center that was going to partner with this charter school that was specifically for students that had been pushed out of traditional schooling. A lot of our kids in that program were in a neighborhood in the valley that was a gang injunctioned neighborhood, and a lot of our kiddos were struggling in traditional schools. So she said, hey, do you want this youth counselor position? It pays, and you get to just kind of work with kids. I'm like, I guess I need a paycheck. So I went and I took it. And, I was just this little brown kid from the desert, walking around this neighborhood being like, hey, little cholito, you want to come play social bingo? Come, follow me. And I thought I was going to be horrible at it, but I completely fell in love with these kids. And our age group was 12 through 19. And I realized I had a gift for connecting with these youth, specifically these kids that had been so marginalized, so ostracized, so demonized in traditional schools. So after 4 years of that and kind of moving up in the nonprofit sector, working with kids, I decided that I wanted to try making a difference from, not just the community outside perspective, but also from within the school walls. So then I went back to school and I went and I joined the teacher education program at UCLA, which is completely social justice geared. And I started working. My first teaching job was 2000. I don't even remember what it was. It was a long time ago. But it was, they were in LA, in some of the most underserved communities in inner city LA, in the, I think it was Arlington Heights area. I fell in love with it. I combined my love of history with my love of working with kids and middle school specifically, and that's where I'm at. So this is my 11th year public, teaching in the classroom. I had 4 years working with kids at the center, and then I took a break after 5 years of teaching, and I was an instructional coach, curriculum specialist for 5 years, and so now I'm back in, and this is my third year back. So my 11th year, yeah.
Awesome.
Oh, so you were,
it's all good. It's all good. So you were at the UCLA College of Education. That's also called Center X, right?
Center X.
Okay. So is Dr. Tyrone Howard still running that?
I don't know. It's all a blur. I don't know. There was not much sleep at that point in my life, much like now. So maybe.
All right. That's cool. But shout out to Dr. Howard. and also Pedro Nogueira, who also spent some time at UCLA. So I don't know if he's still there now, because I know they like to move around to different institutions.
Oh, okay. Well, hopefully if they had a good impact, they're still there, because we need a lot of new teachers coming up hearing the right things in these programs. So,
oh, for sure. So when I was doing my research of you, and this is what I guess a journalist do, so I guess I'm a journalist, or at least I try to be. So I know that you're very proud of your Chicana heritage. Mm-hmm. You're very unapologetic about letting people know who you are and how you identify and how you orient yourself in this world. But also know that you have family that was a huge influence in your development in educational activism. So you talked about your tia. You mm-hmm. talked about your pops as well, who mm-hmm. were very much into that grassroots organizing work within the community. So what I want to know from you is, in what ways do you center your Chicana heritage within your work as an educator, and what influence did your family members have in developing your love for educational activism?
So I did mention my tia. She played a huge role in, those 4 years when I was working in the youth center. And as far as my dad, my dad and I have a very, complicated relationship. He was gone from my life for my middle school and high school years. And so I knew a lot about him, and I knew him as a younger child, and I've been able to grow close with him since then. But what I did know about him was that he was super, super proud to be Chicano. He was super active in the movement. He had such an intense experience in both the most positive and in the most positive and the most negative ways of what it means to be a Chicano in this country. And so for a long time, because I was angry at him, I rejected that part of myself. I didn't exactly want to embrace that, because it meant embracing him. And at that time, I didn't want to do that. And I didn't want to know more about what he had been through. And I didn't want to know his struggle. But, you know, we have really repaired our relationship ever since I graduated from high school. And so hearing his stories, hearing him passing on this oral history, him talking about the movement, him talking about, you know, these kids that he worked with that, you know, were flailing in this society that we create that doesn't welcome everyone in, and they turn to gangs and they find their alternative families in those ways. You know, I just really started to connect with him and appreciate his struggle that also included why he had been absent from our lives. You know, that was part of the struggle of what it means to be brown growing up in this country. This embracing of who I am hasn't come easily. I think that as I begin to teach and I begin to see in the same age that I struggled, my students also struggling with their own, you know, ethnicity, their own self-pride, their own self-worth, you know, it helped me actually helping them. It helped me embrace that part of myself. And especially since I've become a mom, you know, I became a mom 6 years ago, that further prompted my own healing and my own acceptance of who I am. And so it has been a long journey, but through that embracing of my identity and, you know, being able to shout that I am Chicana and that I am proud and that, no, my Spanish isn't perfect. Yes, I listen to oldies and South, you know, in Southern California growing up, you know the lingo, and I have all these little Chicana friends that were sort of living in between worlds like me. And so like all of that is just, I used to be ashamed of that. I used to be not Mexican enough, not whatever white American was, you know, growing up and what I was exposed to. And so, but yeah, that's a huge part of who I am. And I think that the activism piece goes hand in hand with my commitment to working with brown and black communities. And so it's all kind of just combined into who I am and this very intentional decolonization process of my own identity, of my thoughts. And that, in, you know, goes hand in hand with my own decolonization of my pedagogy, of my praxis. You know, now I nerd out all the time about this stuff with my dad. And so it's just been this really cool, like, evolving process. And yeah, I mean, that was long. I'm just going on and on.
No, but yeah, listen, this is your spotlight. This is your spotlight. So we're here for you to share your story. So please don't be bashful.
All right.
Share as much as you want to share.
Yeah, so that's me. And I think that's important because as a parent and as also role model for my students, you know, being very open about how learning to embrace and love and celebrate and own and learn more about who you are, especially as a brown or black, you know, student, young person, like there are extra steps you have to go through because you have been stripped of that intentionally. And so that has been the most liberating, empowering journey for me. And it's a place of empowerment, you know, and I want to be able to pass that on to my daughter and pass that on to my kiddos.
For sure. So before I ask you this question, sure, I want to put out the disclaimer that the Latinx community is not a monolith. So I just want to put that out there. I mean, I know particularly in California, there's a very huge Mexican population. So yeah, Chicanos, Chicanas, all over the state.
Yeah.
So what I want to know from you is, in your opinion, what do you believe are the main issues or challenges that specifically impact Latinx students and even teachers in K-12 schools, based on your experience?
Yeah. So there are some broader educational inequities, right, that impact all kids, more specifically students who are experiencing poverty. And as we know, based on research statistics, that living in poverty does disproportionately impact our Latinx and our Black youth and our Indigenous Native youth. And so, but there are definitely some very specific inequities that I think impact our Latino students. I think there's a lot of language and culture loss. I think that we don't celebrate the knowledge of multiple languages and what that means in a cognitive developmental way. And we don't appreciate and celebrate that here. And so there's a lot of shutting down of languages. There's a lot of funneling kids who may not necessarily be, you know, literate in English, you know, funneling them into these lower level classes where they get really low cognitive, you know, not very rigorous work. You know, they get these repetition programs and they get these worksheets. And sometimes they get put into the classes with teachers who really don't want to be there, who really don't, you know, want to celebrate their cultural capital and their linguistic capital. I think that that's a really huge part I also know that we are underrepresented in curriculum, and that we're the entire history curriculum in California, and probably in, you know, in every state in the United States, because supposedly California is like the more liberal, inclusive state, right? But like, we are still completely marginalized and, you know, pushed to the side when it comes to inclusion in curriculum, and everything is told from a white Euro perspective. And so you've got this like celebration of this Mexican-American war, you know, without really getting into like the details about what that meant for the people, the indigenous people of those lands, and how land loss and land acquisition and everything that we're trying to, you know, fight for now really has roots in some of these really damaging, violent events in history. But those stories aren't told. You know, in terms of, and like you said, the Latino culture, the Latinx community is so wide and diverse. We don't honor that, and we don't respect that, and we put everybody under umbrella terms, and we don't really differentiate what different groups may need. I just recently learned that up until I think the 80s, Mexican was the only option to choose on a census. And so we have for a long time just kind of grouped everybody under Mexican. And I know that within the Latinx community, like, there is so much diversity, and that sometimes we turn against each other. And I think it's because we haven't, as a country, we haven't done enough within our curriculum or within, you know, the way that we implement different strategies to really appreciate the diversity within the Latinx community. And how do we, you know, start to disaggregate data, and how do we start to really, like, you know, target students with where they're at? I think that there's also a lot of machismo that we need to deal with, and that we, you know, and we're seeing that now as, like, you know, my students are becoming more and more comfortable with talking about gender and sexual diversity. I think that they're facing a lot of this sort of very macho response within their own families. They're feeling that sort of exclusion and that sort of loss. And that's a very dangerous place for a lot of my students. I also know that I've always worked in schools that are majority, you know, Black youth and Latinx youth. And we've had full-on riots between the kids, because when you're given scraps, you scrap. I literally had riot training at the school I taught at in LA, like, where they had us as teachers, like, branch out and, like, put our hands out like this and then, like, move in, you know, because we would have constant fights between our kids. And it was racially motivated. And I think that speaks to another issue facing our youth. You know, they're pitted against each other. They don't realize how much overlap there is within the Afro-Latino community. You know, I have students who, you know, who have this beautiful, rich, dark melanin skin busting out in Spanish, and everyone is shocked because we don't honor the diversity within the Latinx community. You know, aside from that, there's, you know, there's everything that is impacting all, you know, all of our kids that are living in poverty. You know, I've worked with kids, like I mentioned earlier, that are in gangs, that are misunderstood, that are, their native language is shut down. They're demonized. They're expelled. You know, Latino kids are still suspended at higher rates than white peers. They're still pushed into special ed, you know, without really having a catch-all sort of solution for students that they don't know what to do with. There's a lot of racism. There's a lot of anti-immigrant sentiment that is, you know, perpetuated by the people in power, not just in power in the country, but in power within our school boards, you know, in power within our school hierarchy. You know, that whole hierarchical approach completely leaves out parents. And so we have this situation where we want to serve our students, but yet we're excluding their parents because we're not including their native tongues, and we're not declaring ourselves spaces of sanctuary for our undocumented families. And, you know, families are being broken up. Families are being traumatized. You know, my brown kids are looking at, you know, kids like Adam Toledo being shot dead in the streets. You know, they're looking at kids who have worked their whole lives to get a college degree, suddenly having that being dangled in between politicians that, you know, as like a ping pong ball. The amount of weight that my students have to carry, it's too much sometimes. And we're not sensitive enough to their own multicultural approaches to what health, mental health, and social emotional health look like. I think also just, you know, things like standardized curriculum and standardized testing. You know, my students just finished standardized tests. Only certain students who score at a certain level can get electives. So I've got all of these kids who are just completely shut down because they don't even want to bother because they've never had an elective before ever. And what? So, yeah, they would, you know, yeah, they don't score high enough. And so they're choosing their electives using this form and I'm like, you know, super encouraging because I'd love for them to be able to at least, you know, hope for one. But, you know, some of these kids, like they've been shut down so many times throughout their schooling. By the time they get to seventh and eighth grade, like they really don't see themselves in this, included in this opportunity that is offered to other kids. And so we do, we have high levels of dropout, and middle school is the place to try and change that around. But, you know, some of these kids, they're just so shut down before they even get a chance because that's what they're used to. I also live in a very, in an area with a lot of foster youth, and a lot of our foster babies, they have a set of trauma that they've been through that they're carrying with them, the weight that they're carrying with them. And yet we're trying to funnel money into school police and to policing our communities versus getting counseling and different creative therapies that can speak to their maybe cultural interests. And so they're just going unserved. They're going unserved. And this has been happening. My dad tells me stories about when, you know, you could get physically hit by a teacher if you speak Spanish in class. You know, and then this whole like ethnic studies debate, like there should be no damn debate. You know what I'm saying? Like we shouldn't even have a need for ethnic studies, but we do. And that should be a mandatory class in middle school and in high school. And elements of it should be incorporated all the way, you know, throughout elementary. And that again is another issue that isn't specific to the Latinx community, but is absolutely impactful for kids, you know, that are part of the Latinx community. I mean, that's just the tip of the iceberg. I could go on, but those are the things that come to mind.
So let's talk about ethnic studies for a second.
Yes.
Now, we know that in recent weeks, there's been a lot of political rhetoric, particularly from the right wingers, about banning critical race theory in K-12 schools, which is totally crazy because it doesn't really exist anyway in our K-12 school system. Critical race theory is a framework that provides a lens for us to look at the different issues that we're speaking of within the context of race, class, gender, and all these other intersectional elements that, you know, we talk about so often. But with regard to ethnic studies, and right now, we have a lot of different states that are trying to push for ethnic studies. Last time I checked, you have Connecticut, who's now offering required high school courses in Black and Latino studies. New Jersey's trying to do DEI courses right now. Oregon is developing ethnic study standards. Washington State is adopting a resolution that will lay out a process for developing an ethnic studies graduation requirement. And then we have California, where you are, your home state, where after years of fighting, if we're going to be real, they have unanimously approved, the Board of Education unanimously approved a model for ethnic studies curriculum for its K-12 students. But here's the issue, though, and I'm sure you're very much aware of this because you are in the state, right? So right now, we have currently within the curriculum, and I don't know if they've changed it yet, but out of the 400 pages within this whole curriculum, less than a quarter of the curriculum is dedicated to Chicano/Latinx studies. 77 pages out of approximately 400 pages. But yet, within your state, a little more than half of the student population is either Mexican or just some other Latinx group, right? Within your student body. So, and there's been some talks about the Jewish community too. They've had some issues with some of the content as well, or the lack thereof.
Yeah.
So what I'm wondering is, what are your overall thoughts about the ethnic studies curriculum within your state, if you had a chance to review it or peruse it? And is it possible to create an ethnic studies curriculum that equitably and accurately covers the full experiences? So when we talk about full, we're talking about the cultural, the historical, and the current lived experiences of all historically marginalized groups. Is it possible to even do that equitably?
Yeah. So there's so many things I want to say about this. First of all, it's good to have a starting point for ethnic studies curriculum.
Yes.
And I think that what the danger is, there's a few dangers in this. I think that having it mandated and prescribing a certain number of weeks for teachers is contrary to what ethnic studies is supposed to be, right? Because ethnic studies is really supposed to provide a window and a mirror for students, but it's centered in student identity and student stories.
Yes.
And so I think that it's within a school year, and some schools don't even have it the whole school year. They're still just limiting it to like a semester. You're not going to be able to fully, you know, dig into the depth that you should to give these different groups the time that they deserve. That's just not going to happen. But I think that within the provided curriculum and within any trainings that go along with that provided curriculum, there needs to be a very clear understanding that you are being guided by your students and their stories. And so there needs to be room for teacher autonomy to be able to craft this curriculum centered around what their student stories are. And so I think that that freedom and that room, that space needs to be given for that, because it's not just a checkoff box, right? Like, it's not just a checkoff box where you, okay, I covered this group, I covered that group, I covered this group. And although that would be great that there would be time to cover every single group, like, and then it feels like we're going back to the old days of standardized, you know, history testing where you're just trying to like make sure you cover everything versus really digging in depth as to where your students need to and want to go. So how can you both expose them to different groups, but also like really tailor the curriculum based on their own identity? So for my students, it would be majority Black, Latino, Black, Latinx, and some Asian Pacific Islander, but also within the other topics, like there's room for intersectionality, right? Like, so if we're talking about the LGBTQ community, like we can also weave in the Latinx experience, which is exactly what I did this year with my students. And so it's not like we're just talking about the Latinx experience for this one unit and then we move on. Like that's not realistic. That's not what our students' lives are. So when we're talking about women, when we're focusing on women, we're again weaving in what does that look like within the Latinx culture? Like what are some [S2] Right. [S1] Of the struggles you specifically deal with as a daughter of an immigrant, right? Or when we're talking about immigration, again, you're weaving it in. And so, you know, this last year has been really hard to teach ethnic studies with, we have 35-minute classes all online. And so, you know, I often felt guilt about like, oh, I didn't give this group enough time. I didn't give that group enough time. I didn't give this group enough time. But when I pulled back and stepped back and really listened to my students, like they were able to be exposed to different groups within every single unit that we did. And so I think that is important to remember when we're talking about this ethnic studies curriculum. One, not to make it so mandated and so strict that we're forgetting to center our students' voices and our students' identities, and we're willing to like maybe follow where they lead. Because guess what? They may know better than the people that created that damn curriculum. and
this is
their stories, you know? And so that, and then I think also we need to, so that we're not turning it into this prescriptive checkbox approach, we need to have quality training that goes with it. And we need to have the right people teaching it. Because if we don't, we're going to have somebody who's like, nope, sorry, we already covered the brown folks. Let's move on to the next group. You know what I mean? Or they're not really invested and engaged and they don't understand the depth of their students' stories and they don't really appreciate or connect to that. So I think that those are important pieces we can't forget when we're rolling out any curriculum. And I just think like for this year, for example, we started off with an entire unit. I write my own curriculum, by the way, for middle school, because there's no middle school curriculum out there. And in fact, my ethnic studies elective is the only one in our whole district. And it's only there because I advocated for it. But like our entire first unit was all about my students coming in and telling their stories. And so I have, you know, majority Latinx and Black students, but there's a lot of like cross-cultural students. I have a lot of Afro-Latinos. I have a lot of mixed kids up here where we live. There's a lot of like, you know, kids like my own little Euro-Blaxican baby, you know? And so they were able to weave in all of these beautiful, colorful parts of themselves. And so when we would go and study all these other groups, the whole point was like, who's a window, who's a mirror? And so if they are Latino, if they are Latinx, they're constantly reflecting back on that so that it's not just living within one unit, right? Because that's the whole point of the course. And so I hope that when people are rolling out that curriculum, that they're really remembering those pieces. This is student led. This is not like our identities don't stop at the end of one unit and at the beginning of the next or whatever. And that they have the right people teaching that will remember those and that will honor our kids' stories and center them.
And there are a few points that I want to make to just qualify what you're saying. I think for one, we can't silo the experiences of each racial or ethnic group, because the reality is there's some interconnectedness. There's some mm-hmm. intersection between them. I mean, just looking at Latinx history, for instance, there's some intersection with indigenous history, with certain tribes. Yeah. We talk about the Aztecs and Olmecs, right? Like, mm-hmm. there is a history where those groups intersect, and the different tribes within the indigenous community intersect with some of the Latinx groups. Mm-hmm. It's out there,
mm-hmm.
you know? And I actually learned that watching John Leguizamo's Latin History for Morons, which was just totally funny. And I've been a fan of John Leguizamo for a long time. So I was like, let me check this out. And it was very well done. If people haven't watched it, they could watch it on Netflix. It's comedy, but it's also serious at the same time, right? Yeah. So it's real good stuff. But I also feel like with regard to curriculum being autonomous, the way that our teacher education programs function is such that they don't teach us how to be autonomous. They teach us how to follow the script.
Mm-hmm.
They teach us how to follow scope of sequence. If one exists within the school district we do work in, but it doesn't teach us how to create our own curriculum. And I feel like that's an element that we need to implement within our teacher education programs.
Absolutely. As a
system that you develop when you get into your district, you know, post practicum, mm-hmm. post student teaching. Like, we need to start it early on, be more proactive about that.
Yeah. And it wasn't until I was able to take a step out of the classroom. And part of my job in those 5 years as a curriculum specialist was to create the 6th, 7th, and 8th grade social studies curriculum, and to provide not a prescriptive curriculum, but just sort of like a frame, and providing texts, which is one of the most, you know, time consuming, but also super important piece in curriculum writing, is really finding the right texts. And so had I not been able to have those 5 years to just really dig into that, I wouldn't be able to create the curriculum to the level that I do now. And I just think it's such a shame when we're paying these outside companies and these outside corporations instead of just pulling out a certain teacher for a year. Because, you know, on every campus, there's a teacher that everyone jacks their curriculum because it's the bomb, but that person never gets paid for it. Right?
Come on now.
I'm just so tired of people getting outside experts to come in and create things for our students when you already have people doing that. Like, you need to, you know, but not pile on, you know, 15 more things for them to do, but like, give them the space and the pay to do it. And we know our kids, right? And so, like, I think, like, creating this framework for ethnic studies and what it can look like in a state, providing guidelines, providing texts, but damn, man, like, we're professionals, right? Like, we've been doing it. So that's what really irks me about the whole ethnic studies for California sort of battle. You know, I mean, and it's just one example of how we aren't honored as professionals with this experience, with this potential, right? We just need the space and time and money, fair pay to do those things. And we don't respect teacher autonomy, and we don't respect our expertise. And we're looked down on if we stay in the classroom versus move on up, right, into this hierarchy that exists. And so I'm 100% with you on that. And like, one of the most valuable things I did as a coach was to work with my history teachers and to co-create. And when I came back into the classroom, I was like, yeah, I got all my curriculum all ready to go. And I still had to change so much of it because I still was creating it from outside the classroom, and I could only, you know, rely on their knowledge so much. And so for outsiders to be thinking that they can create and craft what our kids are going to do in the moment, it's not fair. It's not realistic. And it's completely, you know, hopping over the experts who are leading these discussions and these learning experiences in the room. And so I'm completely with you. We need to do better in our teacher prep programs, but we also need to do better within our districts too. You know?
Yes. And I believe these prescriptive curricular models exist because we have this sense of urgency within our school districts. And if anybody's familiar with the characteristics of white supremacy culture,
I got a post coming for that. And that urgency, that sense of urgency.
Kuhn and Kenneth Jones, late late Kenneth Jones, God rest his soul. They break this thing down, and if I'm not mistaken, Timo Kuhn actually updated the characteristics. I saw a post about it on Instagram. So this sense of urgency, this sense of immediacy, like we need it now. We can't wait. We don't believe in, you know, this idea of letting things develop and go through its own evolution, right? And when you talk about curriculum, I had Principal Cafele on the show not too long ago, and he pretty much held up a paper like this.
He said, "Sorry, say that again. I couldn't hear you."
I'm sorry. So I had Principal Cafele on the podcast, and he held up a paper just like this. And he said, "This is curriculum. It's just a document." But as a teacher, you have to breathe life into it. Because teaching is an art form. So when you leave curriculum to be a framework, you're still going to have a subgroup of teachers who are going to be scratching their heads, wondering, like, what the hell am I supposed to do with this paper? Like, I need more direction. And it just goes back to the training. How do we get our teachers to a place where you can give them a framework? Not a prescription, but a framework where they have the creative license to take it wherever they want to go with it.
And wherever their kids lead them, right?
Right.
I think that's the thing, is like you and your students have to breathe life into it. Like, you know, I teach a period of time that may not be as familiar or as interesting to my students, but I always take time to pull them and see, like, where are their interests and how can I weave in those things? And, you know, where are they asking the most questions? Where are they struggling the most? Where can they most relate within themselves in the curriculum? And so, yeah, it comes to life with the teacher, but it's also in partnership with the students. And it varies per class too, you know, and per kid within each class. And so the rigidness, it can't exist, but at the same time, you need enough supports within that framework to, and again, giving teachers time and fair pay to be able to dig in and see what does that look like with their kids in that class, you know?
For sure. So right now, I want to talk about ESTE Publishing. Let's talk about that, because you exercise your autonomy as an educator. You said, you know what, F this, I'm going to go ahead and create my own curriculum and all these resources that I can share with other teachers, but also expose my students to. And I know it's an evolving initiative. It's an evolving company, and you're still in the infantry of it. But, you know, I went on the website and I said, wow, like, you got some dope material on there, and I couldn't tell that you needed to update it. It just looked really good.
That's good.
So here's what I want to do. And this is the cool thing about being on StreamYard. So for those who are listening, we're gonna actually preview the ESTE Publishing website for our viewers to see. Cool. But we'll try to describe as best as we can the different features of it so that you all can go ahead and visit it. So for those who are listening with us today, the website is estepublishing.com. So that's E-S-T-E publishing.com for those who are listening with us today. So I'm going to go ahead and share the website, and we can go ahead and have a conversation about it. You can walk us through what's going on the website, because you have a lot of cool things going on. So here it is right here.
It's my baby right here. Oh, that's there my niece. Go.
Oh yeah, that's your niece.
That's my baby. So you know, I got a zero budget, so gotta use who I can. And those are some of my former students, and their parents gave me permission to use their beautiful smiles on there.
Awesome, right here.
Of my babies.
So I want you to tell me what inspired you to start ESTE Publishing. And what's the overarching mission of this company? What are you trying to accomplish with students as well as educators?
So I mentioned the teacher who, you know, people would always take their curriculum and not pay for it. So that was me back in the day. So I've never been satisfied with the history lessons as they are presented in the textbooks. I've always, you know, created my own lessons, and I've always, you know, tweaked the lessons that I was provided. And so when I was able to take a step out after 8 years of teaching in public schools, I was able to take that step out and really, you know, work on my craft of writing and creating and really, you know, leading with historical literacy in mind and critical thinking and empathy and humanity. And so all of the things that I've been incorporating, you know, throughout my teaching, I was like, you know, putting that into my curriculum. And then after 5 years in that job, that was overlap with the former president and just, you know, everything was just bubbling up and I was just fucking pissed. And I was just,
sure.
I was so beyond pissed and I needed an outlet for it. And I was able to find it through my work, but I was also working for someone else. And so I had to follow their, you know, expectations and work within their mission. And so it got to the point where I just couldn't hold back all the things that I wanted to do and all the ways that I wanted to make an impact. I couldn't do it under someone else's expectations anymore because I was impatient and I was passionate and I was sick of this shit. And so I was like, I'm going to just do this for myself. I'm going to start my own publishing company. And I'm going to create, you know, social justice centered curriculum. I'm going to present real history. I'm going to give kids an opportunity to hear from voices who they rarely hear from. I'm going to give kids a chance to see themselves represented. And I'm going to do it as my own boss. And someday my end goal is to publish middle school social studies curriculum and ethnic studies curriculum and to completely make the history textbooks irrelevant and unnecessary. They're a waste of money. And just like we were talking earlier, you know, in terms of the curriculum, like I want to create it so that it is a guideline. And so, you know, having worked with first year teachers as well as, you know, 10th year teachers, like giving them enough space so that they can really, you know, insert their own personality, their own styles. Yeah, exactly. But also at the same time, like some of our first year teachers and second year teachers are struggling. Sometimes they're like, just give me something. I just need to go in there. I haven't slept in a week or whatever. So, you know, having like had that experience coaching teachers and also being a social studies teacher and also, you know, being passionate with my activism, I'm pouring all of that into it. And I'm also really pouring in my knowledge and my newfound understanding of the adolescent brain. I've been doing a lot of really nerdy reading. I'm just so fascinated at the middle school mind, how misunderstood and how underserved it is, and how we are not lining up our supports with the middle school age group. And so I'm incorporating within like my curriculum, you know, opportunities for them to really tap into those sort of shifts that they're going through cognitively as well as physiologically. I mean, you know, physically, it's just such a peak time for them to deeply engage into the work of social justice. That's why I'm so passionate about this age group. I'm passionate about this project. So as you can see, the vision of ESTE, ESTE stands for, by the way, empowering students through education. Although I really feel that we as teachers, we are not empowering our students. We're just guiding them to empower themselves. And you can see the vision here is to foster equity and student empowerment through engaging, rigorous, and social justice-centered curriculum. So, and then there's some of the goals right there. And I'm not going to be neutral about it. And I've had a lot of conversations with friends that are like, ooh, Lucia, you know, you're really... you're really divisive there with that language. And, you know, you mentioned white supremacy a lot. Don't you want to make money off of this? Don't you want to make it available to the broadest audience? Hell no, I don't. I don't want certain people teaching and using my curriculum because it has to come from a place first of understanding of self, understanding of privilege, understanding of what our students are going through. And so my curriculum is not going to be for everyone and it's not going to be neutral. And it's going to piss a lot of people off. And it is going to be grounded in critical race theory, as it should be, as I think all of our curriculum should be from K through 12. So, you know, I think that my goal is to provide curricular support. And then perhaps maybe someday, if I'm not teaching full time, maybe additional support beyond that, instructional coaching, workshops. I've provided a few workshops for my district on equity. I'm really passionate about equity and what that actually looks like in action, and how, you know, racial injustice and social injustice, like it all is a part of educational inequity. And we don't honor that. We think it's very surface level when we talk about equity in schools. It's about providing, you know, certain resources, which, yes, that's a part of it. But to dig deeper and to realize how we do not exist in a vacuum at schools, that we are a part of and a reflection of and an influence on, at the same time, the surrounding community. So I'm really passionate about having people understand, like, that school is a microcosm of this greater social environment that we're in, and that we can't leave things out like politics. You know, we can't leave things out like identity and sexuality and gender. Like, all of those things are playing out on our campuses anyway. And so teachers need a guide on how to navigate that for themselves and how to help students navigate that. And I hope to do that through ESTE. As you mentioned, it's still definitely, you know, in its infancy. I started it, I think, 3 years ago. I just, you know, I had a friend who knew a copyright attorney, and I just went and I, you know, little by little started making the payments and setting up the LLC, and it's like a legit company now. And I want to center people who are not considered in the world of academia as experts. That's something that I'm going to really, really stick to when it comes to my curriculum, because I am not the expert on all things, and I don't know a lot. And so, for example, I recently created a unit on, I call them investigations. So it's an investigative unit, and every investigative unit has an investigation question, and students look through multiple sources in order for them to form, you know, an evidence-based stance on that, a claim. And so I created an investigative unit on Islamophobia. And I reached out to whoever was interested. And I said, hey, I'm doing this unit. This is for kids in this age group. I don't know if it's on there, but yeah, so it's like an all-inclusive unit. So those are some of the things I have available now. And it's only from what I've taught this year, because I just don't have the capacity to like write what I'm not teaching. And also it allows me to try these things out with my kids in real time and make adjustments. But so the unit on Islamophobia, I actually interviewed people who were willing to share their stories as American Muslims. And so it's not centering my voice. It's not centering, you know, some white professor who has studied Islam from a distance. Like, it's really about centering people's experiences. And I argue all the time that we are all experts in our own stories. And so I want to interview some of my students and put them inside the curriculum. You know, why are we only looking at published texts as sources? You know, why aren't we doing our, right. Yeah, you know, like, we just finished this unit in my ethnic studies class, and we were talking about immigration and undocumented people in the United States and what their stories are. And my student was telling us about her mom and her mom's journey. Her mom's journey is what we should be learning and listening to. Right? Like the human face, you know, I don't want to go and read what the hell a textbook has to say about it. Nah, fuck that. Like, these are our stories and we can tell them better than anyone else. My dad is visiting. I want to get him on film, and I want him to talk to me about the Chicano movement. That in itself is a text, you know? And so, yeah, he's this fool from New Mexico that nobody knows about, but that's the whole point, is that our voices have been silenced. They haven't been included. And so I want to center them. I also want to center different kinds of texts, because back to your point about white supremacy culture, the written word is not the only word, right? Cool. So like, how are we including storytelling and poetry? And like, and that's another part of you know, critical race theory, is that counter narrative, that counter storytelling.
Yep. Storytelling,
yep. Including all that, yeah. So what you're looking at now are my units that I provide. And so each of these lasts maybe about 3 weeks, depending on how a teacher paces them. And what I meant about updating my website is I want to make sure I have the newest versions available, because I modify things as I'm teaching them. And this is a good tip for teachers to consider, or this is something maybe a lot of kids may not come in with prior knowledge of because of their age or whatever. But, you know, I try to... Like, for example, the Japan, does studying Japan confirm or challenge popular ideas about warriors? And so with the, even though this is like medieval Japan, right? And like people are like, you can't include social justice issues within the Middle Ages in Japan. Yeah, you can. That whole unit is about challenging stereotypes that we have of what it means to be a warrior. And so within there, I'm including texts that talk about how samurai, you know, were expected to be trained in the arts and in poetry writing, and that meditation was a huge part of their practice. But not only that, there were these badass women called onobugeisha who were also there fighting on the battlefield. And so kids start with thinking about their own ideas about what it means to be a warrior, and then they're you know, as they continue into the unit, they're asking themselves, does this confirm or does this challenge what my preconceived ideas were? And so, you know, history is a story of us all. And so within every single unit, there is a chance to make a connection to what's happening in our world today, because the human experience has not changed that much, even though everything around us has. Yeah. You know, the early Christianity unit is about power and privilege. And it's about how the, you know, perspective of Christianity changed depending on who happened to be in power at that time, right? Suddenly you have, you know, suddenly you have Constantine who's coming up, and suddenly it's cool to be a Christian versus like you used to be fed to the lions. And it's about power and it's about position. And the Aztec society one, right? It's like, I was inspired with that one because we were talking about who are the most valuable people in society. Well, you know, maybe it's not the people who have power. Maybe it is the farmers, because as we saw in, you know, during COVID, we were seeking support from the people who provide us with the food on our table, with the people that are working at the Walmarts, that are working, you know, and restocking our shelves. And so this right here, this unit really has kids questioning, like, who do we value in society, and why, you know? And so within every single unit, like, there is an opportunity to get kids to think critically about societal issues, about how they can empower themselves, how they can feel pride in their, you know, parents that are out there, you know, working in the fields. And, you know, it's really about like making connections and celebrating the human story and not just one person's story. I love talking about history. Can you tell?
and that's what's up, though.
Yeah.
But I'm glad that you were transparent about the process of developing these materials and the amount of work that it takes. Oh, and one thing that I don't think you mentioned is the fact that it's not you by yourself. You have a team.
Oh,
you
no, have it's me.
Colleagues. But don't you have some colleagues that help you from time to time?
It's all me. I would say that it's me, but I rely on other people to share their stories with me so that I can include it in the curriculum. And I rely on my kids a lot. I'm always like, okay, tell me what sucked, y'all. Just be honest. You know, tell me what, you know. And so, like, I'm a one person. ESTE Publishing is a one person show, but it is not centered in my knowledge only, I guess I should say. So that's why it's slow, right? Like, I had this plan in my head, and then COVID hit, and I find myself, you know, teaching from home in 35 minute chunks and having to completely redo all of those units. And so, you know, next year I'll be teaching US history so that I can finally start to write some of that curriculum, because I haven't been able to really write anything that I'm not teaching real time, just because it is just me. And eventually someday I hope that I actually make money and I need an editor, cause my typos and my, all my spelling errors and my grammar, all that shit, like, it just, I'm not about it. I would love to find a social media person, cause then I could actually get off my phone sometimes. But, you know, like, right now it's a passion project that I hope turns into something big, that I will keep pushing for, you know, it to turn something big. I'm starting local. And so this summer I'm packaging my ethnic studies curriculum for middle school. And then I'm taking it to my district, and I'm like, hey, I don't want to be the only ethnic studies teacher in our district. Here you go. Let's get these into different schools, you know? So that's the goal. And then maybe someday it will just be, you know, I'll have a team.
Yeah. And I talked to you about that because, you know, intellectual property is real. Like, we got to protect our intellectual property. So,
yep.
And I know you have everything trademarked and copyrighted. I'm hoping at this point,
yes.
So
yes, they can't
do nothing, because I've seen so many people just voluntarily just give up their brain.
And I've learned that the hard way.
And they don't get no kind of compensation back.
Yep. And I've learned that, and I still struggle with that. Like, I'll be honest, like, I still definitely struggle with imposter syndrome, and I'm like, who's going to give this chick, you know, money, you know, who, you know, but like, my shit's good and I'm good at what I do. And I have to remind myself of that. And I have friends that, you know, are like, dude, stop giving stuff away for free. And like, you are qualified and you can do this. And so, but it is, especially when it comes to, you know, brown and black folks, you know, how many times throughout history has so-and-so invented something and that person's name is never even heard, right? Like, because somebody else has come in and taken the credit that has power. So I'm definitely protecting all my stuff, you know, and it, a lot of it just has to do with me being ready to really, you know, just take that step. I told you even in the email, I was like so anxious about doing this interview because I'm a reluctant activist. Like, I just want to teach. I'm an introvert in a lot of ways. I'm awkward as fuck. I'm a nerd. I just want to teach. I want to be a good mom. I want to be, you know, but like we can't be silent anymore. And so, you know, I started this project and I'm going to see it through, you know, and I'm going to see it through. And if it means having to, you know, go out there and put myself out there and, you know, and I'm okay making waves. I've been causing some tsunamis where I live for a while now. So
I'm good with that. They scared of you.
I'm all right with that.
Is this your first interview?
Yeah.
Well, wow.
I have a friend who's she's a professor and she's the head of the teacher ed program at Pasadena City College. So she's had me do a few things. And I, like I said, I've done some workshops and stuff. I prefer to stay behind the scenes. But yeah, you're my first interview, Kwame.
We making history, y'all. We making IDTALK4ED Educators Live history. Lucia Reyes has her first interview on this platform.
It's going good. I'm having fun, actually.
you're doing a great job considering this is the first like real interview. So kudos to you.
Thank you. And
just to let you know, once we get it all cleaned up, this will be something that hopefully you'll embed on the ESTE Publishing website because people need to see this face. Okay.
Yeah, absolutely.
People need to see your face. It takes some time, especially when you're someone who's introverted and behind the scenes. It takes time to get used to being, you know, up front. I mean, believe it or not, as someone who had an IEP and was in special education for the first four grades of my K-12 schooling, the diagnosis for me was all about speech, expressive speech, struggling to verbalize my thoughts and emotions, because even though I know what I want to say in my head, it doesn't come out in a way that's coherent for people to understand.
Yeah.
And that took time for me to develop. So you fast forward to now, you know, 30 plus years later, you know, I'm doing podcasts, talking to people. I'm actually teaching. I'm doing public speaking every day. I'm doing workshops and conferences. And it blows my mind because that wasn't me.
Yeah.
That wasn't me for a lot of years. So it takes time to get to this place, but you got to get yourself out there. That's how people going to know.
I know it.
So this is why we do this platform, to get you out the shell and to...
Well, I appreciate it. Thanks for yanking me out. I'm prepping myself for it.
All right, we're gonna wrap things up. I want to make sure you get back to your family. So we have the lightning round. So I have some quick hitter questions that I'd like to ask you.
Sure.
So we don't need, you know, elaborate, you know, answers. They're pretty much very straightforward. Let's start with the first one. What do you do for self-care? All this work you're doing, how do you take care of yourself?
I spend a lot of time with my kiddo. We go out to the middle of the desert. We watch the sunset from the back of my car and sleep when I can. I'm a big napper this year, especially just spending time with my teacher homies and my close friends.
All right, cool. Those are all important. One book that you're currently reading.
I forget what the exact title is, but it's all about being an empath, which I've been exploring the last year and a half. And what does that actually mean? Is that a real thing? Like, how does that, because I definitely relate to a lot of that. So I'm reading basically like a survival guide for being an empath.
All right, cool. If you can invite three influential figures, dead or alive, to dinner, who would they be?
Oh man, I would invite my nana and my papa. I invite my grandparents, my mom's parents. Maybe Malinche. Malinche.
All right, awesome. And then finally, who would you like to see as a guest on this podcast? Who would you like to see?
I would like to see some students, actually. I'd like to see some students and perhaps some parents. But I think really, you know, bringing students on, like, that has always been the most powerful thing for me in learning where it is we need to go with education. And so anywhere from, you know, from any age group, really, I think would be incredible. But obviously, our middle and high school students can talk a lot about, you know, what they actually experience in schools in terms of inequity and, you know, what they would like to see change. I'd love to see student voices uplifted. Yeah.
And I actually had a student, I've had a couple students in the past serve as guests on the show, and they were awesome. One student in particular, I'm going to have to put you on because she is phenomenal. Her name is Jada Huffman, and she has a company called Official I Am History. She creates shirts of historical figures of color that you don't necessarily see within the school curriculum. And what's cool about it is there's an accompanying app where if you scan the barcode on the shirt, you're able to get some biographical information about the figure who features.
What?
No, it is totally dope. Had her last year. So I'm sure since then she's added some more figures. I'll share the website, everything with you after you know we're done with everything. But there are some young people doing some great things.
Cool.
Yeah.
I actually just today had a former student come on and talk to my ethnic studies kiddos. And my former student is trans and was completely transparent and loving and patient. And my kids got to ask so many questions. So I know they would be willing to as well. And they're thinking about how they can actually utilize their knowledge and their expertise in having formerly trained people and like how they can come in and just sort of talk to educators about how we can better support our LGBTQ youth. So I can always, you know, link you up. Alex Soto is the name and they're phenomenal. So that might be another person for you.
That's what's up. I might have to bring some of my former students. I have a few students who are actually graduating from high school this year. So yep. I'm going to see if I can get them on this podcast. You know, that would be great. Just the reason
we have this amazing like network, right? Like this access to these incredible young people. Yeah.
Cool. For sure. All right, Lucia, you've been so gracious with your time. And I know your nana and your daughter, they're waiting patiently for you to come join them. So I want to thank you for coming on the podcast. Thank you for making history today. You are phenomenal. And let's keep doing this work.
Let's do it.
Whatever I can do to support, please let me know. I definitely want to do what I can to amplify what you're doing because what you're doing is revolutionary and people need to know about it. So thank you.
Thank you. You can refer them to Instagram pages, my public page that is going to really center the curriculum that I'll be putting out this summer, and the resources is at a rebellious education, a_rebellious_education. And then my more private page where I also put out some resources and then also just kind of vent and talk a little shit, do a lot of learning, do a lot of, you know, growing, and just probably not the page my students should be following, is at the_rebellious_history_teacher. Wait, is it history_teacher? But
the_rebellious_history_teacher.
Yeah, there's a lot of underscores in there. So yeah, so those are my two pages on Instagram. And then www.estepublishing.com. this summer, I'm really, my focus this summer is a middle school ethnic studies curriculum from the rooter to the tutor, from the beginning to the end, really supporting teachers to support their students in at the middle school grade level. So I'm hoping to put that out and then just sort of touch up my world history units. And so I'm hoping those will all be available during summer to purchase. And then next year I'll be writing early United States history, all from a completely non-white, cisgender, hetero male perspective. We're just, they'll be there in the margins, but I'm just really excited to shift the lens for next year. So then that'll be available the next year. So baby steps, but it's coming. It's coming.
Oh, yes. Yes. They're going to get it. Students, teachers are going to get this, these gifts. But yep. Lucia, thank you again.
Thank you.
And we'll definitely connect in the near future for sure.
Absolutely. All right. Thank you so much. Thank you for listening, watching, everyone. Adios.
All right. All right, adios. All right, y'all. So we are about to end another fantastic episode of IDTALK4ED Educators Live. And as always, I'm your host, Kwame Sarfo-Mensah. And I'm going to wish you all a good morning, good afternoon, good night, wherever you are in the world. And we're going to do this again another time. Peace out, everybody.